So far we've been focusing really on the circulatory system, just delivering oxygen and taking away carbon dioxide. But the circulatory system works closely with a bunch of different systems. In particular, it helps remove wastes from cells. So this is part of the excretory system. As we do different metabolic reactions, we produce chemicals like ammonia that can be toxic if they build up. And so we want to remove those from the cells and excrete them through the excretory system. The circulatory system is going to work closely with the digestive system. It's going to help deliver all that glucose, amino acids, and fats from the digestive system to the individual cells that need them as building blocks for their biomolecules. It's going to work with the endocrine system to deliver hormones from glands to target cells. And then, in sort of a bigger picture kind of way, the circulatory system is going to be really important in distributing heat throughout the body and maintaining homeostasis. So the core of your body stays warmer, and your appendages, your arms and your legs, head, are places where you lose heat. And so as the circulatory system moves around, it moves the cooler blood into the core and the warmer blood out. And that helps you maintain your constant body temperature. And then finally, the circulatory system is going to be responsible for circulating all of the different components of the immune system. So it's going to be the highway that allows your immune system to get to a place where you have an infection or some other kind of issue that the immune system needs to fight. So just briefly, I want to touch on the evolution of circulatory systems and have you recognize that there's a lot of different circulatory systems out there. Ours is one particular version, but there's plenty of animals out there with different solutions to how to get oxygen and get rid of carbon dioxide. The simplest solution is just basic diffusion. Remember, diffusion is moving from an area of high concentration to low concentration. So if there's lots of oxygen outside, not very much inside, it can diffuse directly into cells. And these little flatworms, they're less than a centimeter long. They live in a watery environment and they can just use basic diffusion. They don't have any kind of heart, they don't have any kind of lungs. There are organisms that have what are called open circulatory systems. So they have two of the three parts we've talked about. They have a heart and they have blood, but they don't have blood vessels. And so they have a pump that sort of just keeps the blood sloshing around in the body. And this is going to be what we find in the arthropods, the crustaceans, mollusks, and insects. And if you remember back to our discussion of skeletons and the skeletal system, these are also all of the individuals that have exoskeletons. So they have a hard outer skeleton, and in the inside they have this pump that just sloshes all of the blood around. This is not as efficient as our heart, but if you're not too big and you don't need to move too fast, that's okay. You don't need as much oxygen to make ATP quite as efficiently. Fish have a closed circulatory system, but instead of lungs, they have gills. And if you remember back to our little graphic where we showed blood going to the lungs, back to the heart, and then out to the body, we have the same thing here, but now we're going to the gills. And the gills are these feathery structures right near the front of the fish's head. And as they swim through the water, water flows over these gills. They have lots and lots of surface area, and that's where oxygen is picked up from the water. So fish are breathing oxygen. They're just breathing the dissolved oxygen that occurs in the water. And if there's not enough oxygen in the water, you can kill a fish because they do need that. It turns out the higher the water temperature, the less dissolved oxygen it has in it. So fish often tend to prefer very cold waters because they're more oxygen rich. You could have a closed circulatory system like ours, but have multiple hearts. And here you can see an earthworm has one main heart, but then all of these accessory hearts. And these are going to help pump blood throughout this organism. It's also going to allow earthworms to be cut in half and end up just becoming two earthworms. They don't have one single heart that, if you get disconnected from, your body will no longer function. Some reptiles and all amphibians are going to have a three-chambered heart. So they have a closed circulatory system with lungs, blood vessels, and a heart, but their heart has two atria like we do, but only one ventricle. When the ventricle pumps, it's going to pump some blood to the lungs and some to the body. And as you can imagine, this is a slightly less efficient system than ours because oxygenated and deoxygenated blood is mixing here. And so when you pump, you're going to send some blood back to the lungs that already has oxygen, and you're going to send some blood back to the body that doesn't have oxygen. And this just means that these kinds of organisms can't generate as much ATP as something with a more efficient four-chambered heart. So who has the closed circulatory system, lungs, and a four-chambered heart? That's the birds and the mammals. As a sidebar, there are a few reptiles like crocodiles that also have this system. And this is probably the most efficient system in terms of getting oxygen out of the environment and getting it to your cells. What this allows is birds and mammals to be endothermic. And endothermic means that you can maintain a constant body temperature in spite of the environment around you. If we walk out on a cold morning, our temperature doesn't drop. If we walk out on a really hot Sacramento day, our temperature doesn't go way up. And that's because of this very efficient system. Most other organisms, everything I've showed you before here, is exothermic. And what that means is their body temperature is going to change with the environment. Now, there's some trade-offs. In evolution, there's always trade-offs. Birds and mammals can live just about anywhere. We can live in really cold environments. We can live in really warm environments. If you think about the Arctic and Antarctic, the only organisms that are there that are not in the water are birds or mammals. Frogs and snakes just can't live in an environment like that because they can't warm their body up. The flip side here is that you have to breathe all the time and you have to eat all the time. So birds and mammals have to eat regularly, daily or every other day for sure, just to maintain this constant body temperature. If you've ever known anyone who's had a snake, you know that they don't have to eat very often. You can feed them once a month and that's fine. If you're exothermic, you don't need to maintain a constant high body temperature, but you also can't live in as many places. So classic evolution, certain traits give you advantages in certain environments. In other environments, maybe not the advantage, and we get the development of different kinds of species.